All Things TechIE Podcast, brought to you by two tech junkies, Justin Dawson and Simon Lang. For more, visit www.allthingstech.ie for All Things TechIE.
Welcome on to another episode of All Things Tech, where we are going to be changing things around in 2019, but we are winding down from 2018. Simon Lang is with us in a remote location in a telephone booth again with red, orange and yellow, and we have to admit it's not McDonald's.
No, it's definitely not McDonald's. It's Google-like, but not Google.
There's a hint. It's Google-like, not Google, and it's not McDonald's. Actually, Simon, you know what? Talking about McDonald's, this story hit the Amy magazine, and it's something that Jen, my wife, and myself have talked about before. You know those smart devices that they have for kids in the restaurants?
Yes, that's the ones that they go in and play their games while they're eating their happy meals. And
yeah, well, like, you know what, it's funny, like, this is what I don't get, and as a parent, the two of us are technology driven, but the one thing's for sure is if I'm going to be treating Kieran in the future when he's old enough to a happy meal, I am not going to sit him on that table where he's going to have an iPad in front of me and not communicating with me.
Yeah, no, that's the whole point of those is social family engagement, not let's all sit around and on our own individual phones and not talk to each other.
Do you remember it was tough enough? Like, well, okay, maybe we're not. I said, actually, Rebecca's old enough to make this comment, but it's tough enough to get the kid to eat their food without taking the Happy Meal toy out and starting to play with it. And then they're sticking an iPad in front of them, you know, they're definitely not going.
When the Happy Meal is on its way to the table for us, the toy seems to just disappear out of the box into a handbag somehow, and I don't know how it happens.
Those Christmas fairies, Simon, those Christmas fairies.
Because I was reading that article on it, and it was talking even about the big touch displays as well, not just the kids' iPads, that now a lot of McDonald's have this self-order kiosk.
It's like going into like a store where you want to order, you know, your latest 48-inch TV, and you get a receipt, and it's like, you are number 47, you know. And actually, we're sort of going off topic at the moment, but like, I was in Dublin Airport, and it wasn't actually McDonald's, it was actually Burger King, and I was just waiting there. It's like, I was number 47 and you're serving number 102. Where's my order? And there's no sequence in the numbers. It's like one was 47, the other one was 212, you know. But what the story was is the fact that you see the kids and they're eating a burger with one hand and they're touching the screen on the other. And you're thinking to yourself, is anyone cleaning these devices? Well, someone did a swab test. And it is disgusting. They found fetus, swabs of fetus on the screens.
Yeah, it's the bacteria and stuff that's found in it. And that's what's been making people quite sick in hospitals. I think it's like listeria or something is the symptom too. And it's just like, we don't realize like how many, you often see a parent sit down with a kid and they'd even still baby or get a baby wipe out and clean the table beforehand. Do you think they do that on the iPad or on the, before they let their kids sit down? Not at close, not at all.
Don't forget, it's in this casing, in this white casing that has an edge to it. So you wouldn't, like, I even know from recording videos for hospital ORLO real learning objective videos for our School of Nursing, there is a sequence of how to sanitize and clean a hospital trolley. So again, the same standards should apply to these iPad devices where you don't wipe the dirt into the screen. You know, you want to wipe around the edges and around the borders. Are they doing that properly? Who knows? But I think it's a time that we get rid of the iPads out of these places.
We should encourage family time of people talking and communication person to person versus technology to technology.
And it's interesting you say that, though, because going to the LTSMG, the Learning Technology Space Management Group, over in London in Lakeborough University, it was interesting that we had an actual seminar where we talked about interactiveness with the students. And one of the products is all about letting the student collaborate through their mobile phone and seeing what's on the front screen on their mobile phone. You see that, you see these type of sharing collaboration tools all the time. Mm-hmm. So, but one of the comments made was, what do we have in our hands all the time? Even with students, how many times do we look at it? It's the mobile phone. And it doesn't even make a difference if it's for higher ed. You could have it at conferences as well, where you have people at the back of the room, and if they don't have their laptop or smart device, they will be using their mobile phone. You can share everything that's on the front screen on the mobile phone. Is that the way it's going, though? Is this what people want?
I don't know if it's what people want, but I have seen examples of it where you even have, you have the slides pushed, and you can actually mark up the slides and make notes on the slides as you as their speaker is speaking, and so you save them as a copy to your own device. But I don't know, is it the way it seems to be going? Everything's technology driven. Instead of sending the slides out, you're getting them live, you're marking them up, versus an email that comes later on and you have to flick through it and go, what did he say there? What did she say there? It might be just a quicker, more efficient way if we're going paperless. Mm-hmm. Nowadays, people are making notes on their tablets and Google Keep or whatever the Microsoft equivalent or the Apple equivalent of that is, where you're scribbling your notes on. So it does sound like it's the way things are going, but is it good? I don't know.
Yeah, we welcome your comments. We better give out our Twitter handles, hashtag All Things TechIE, if you want to use that. And we've been sharing on a monthly basis different topics with the hashtag All Things TechIE. We're going to get to that in a moment. If you want to tweet Simon, you can do so at Simon Lang AB and myself at Justin or Dawson. Now, Simon, as 2018 drives to a close, before I ask you the difficult question as what's been your gadget of the year, we have a couple of comments coming in. We're using the hashtag of All Things TechIE, and one of the questions we asked was, the number one pet hate of AV support is, and you fill in the gap. Now, Simon, I know it's a Friday, I know it's 8 a.m. when we're recording this, but what really grinds your gears with AV support? I'll even allow you to have a top 10 if you can't limit it down to a number one pet hate.
Now, funny, because there was one actually that came back about, and I actually, it was one of mine as well, about the whole tapping the microphone when the person gets... Yeah, it's just that thing. And I got to say, that is one that drives, I think, most AV people insane. Or the one I get is where if you are an organization that works, pushes people to be self-reliant, to use the equipment themselves, to connect it themselves, and you hand them all the tools to do it and the instructional videos, and they still
don't watch them.
But expect you to still be able to come and dig them in, and often you're walking in, it's just to stick a cable in the side of the laptop. So in an age where people are meant to be self-reliant, they're not being very self-reliant.
So you know what? I think
it's a frustration probably more than a...
I think my next t-shirt is AV support, not babysitter.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because that's sometimes what we feel like. We are babysitting people. Like in other support roles, is there that much babysitting going on as well? Audiovisual
support? I don't think so. I think if you listen to people like who work in, say, the tech parts, like I call the Googles, the Facebooks, the Twitters and stuff like that, it doesn't sound like they get spoon-fed as much as other companies do. And so we have to be careful, we're not implying the companies we work for, it's just what we're hearing.
It's what we're
hearing. Here it was what we're hearing, that... out there, some companies they you have to do absolutely everything for the user, from even collecting the laptop off their desk for them to the other extreme where you're told, no, we only need you for the large scale events when the CEO is coming in to talk. So it's where's that line in the middle that is the bit we're trying to figure out.
Well, 90% of the time, Simon, I think we're just dealing with other people's anxieties and trying to keep them calm. And yeah, you know, like at times we should have a doctorate because we are nearly doctors of keeping people calm, as if they're going into a hospital ward and getting an operation done. James Scott sent a message in of what grinds his gears. I would say my pet hate is when Prince... Oh, that's what we said. James vigorously tapped the mic and say, is this thing working? And then proceed to whisper through the presentation. That is very true, James.
The whisper through the presentation one is definitely a very big one that lots of people hate.
Well, the amount of times, Simon, that we've set up events in the past where people actually might be on stage and decide, what's that thing in front of me? I don't need that. And literally... decide to step off the stage and not use the stage at all and interact.
And then everyone's looking at you going, what are you going to do? And you're like, okay, try to find a handheld to run up to them, wish to make the point or her. And they're just like looking at you going, I don't need this. And then you're wondering why everyone's complaining at the back of the room why they can't hear.
You know what? And I think that's why the technology and the between the likes of Shure and Sennheiser, how they are really developing technology where it just works in all situations and scenarios, where, for example, the ceiling microphone array that you can have as a tile with, I think it's now 20 or 30 microphones that can detect a person walking around the room and zone in. You know, I think
something like that, or that seems to be quite a common thing for your small meeting rooms. But then your big, large meeting rooms, Revo Labs, or who are a Yamaha company, they have a one that you clip on. It's nearly like the size of a cigarette lighter.
Yes, yeah.
And you clip it on. And you walk around, so there's no belt pack, there's no cable, anything. And they're trying to make those kind of things a little bit more user-friendly, practical, where you just pick it off the charge dock and go. And you can have your... But they're often tied into phone systems more than, like, hangouts or those kind of situations.
I think, Simon, going on this topic, that in the future, if anyone decides to do something as stupid as that and walk away from the microphone, we should be allowed to use catch boxes. And that's a good plug for Catchbox, but Catchbox without the foam and just throw it at their head. I go, oh, sorry, it's not a finished Catchbox. I'm sorry. But there's your microphone, Catch.
Yeah, because the other one I was often looking at, I don't know if you've ever watched an American football match. Okay. And they have a thing called a parabolic microphone, which is basically, it's like a big half sphere dish. Right. With a microphone inside it, and they point it out onto the field so they can hear what the players are saying in when they're standing facing off against each other. It does look like a gun. If I find a picture, I'll send to you. Basically, you can imagine we're talking something about a meter, not maybe quite a meter, but at least 3/4 of a meter wide.
Okay.
And the microphone's in it, and if they literally hold it like a gun kind of thing, and they point it, and it can pick up sound quite a large distance.
It's like a spy radar detector where you can zoom
exactly in. Like that kind of thing. Because I was looking at that from the point of view of, say, this kind of situation, but I was actually thinking of it in a church situation where you have they might bring someone up to the front on an impromptu chat that you have this thing, you just pick it up and you can point it at them. Maybe not the size that the footballers use, but that you could have something like that and it will do its utmost to pick up.
Well,
people,
what other comments have we got in? Steve Ashby says, when a user has no intention of even trying, okay, well, we sort of established that as well of what grind to gears. I remember back in the day when slide projection, when I had one user who booked support every week just so he didn't need to walk to the projector booth to put the carousel onto the projector. I guess this is the old days of slide projection, was always 5 minutes late and never thank you. I think we've had those situations, Simon, in the past as well. Gabe Moronta, I hope I'm pronouncing your surname right, Gabe. The loss of logic / common sense. How do I dial out on this phone system? The same way you do from your desk. What starts with 9, proceed from there with the numbers as needed. How do I log into this PC? The same as your desk. Control-Alt-Delete brings up the login page. But how? Yes, we've had that in the past. You know, this cable. Yeah, this cable that's the same VGA or HDMI cable that's going into the back of your PC. Yeah, that cable.
Mm. And then you see Chris's one. He says, as a former site technician, the fear that people have of pressing the buttons on a touch panel. Oh, I can't touch that in case something happens. And you're like, that's the point. I wanted something to happen.
And you know what, Simon? It's like, it sounds that like we are, well, we actually, sorry, we are professionals in our job. Let's not doubt ourselves. But
no, we are definitely professionals.
We go into hotels and different venues and stuff like that. And people's like, oh, you can't touch that touch panel. It's like, well, it's an end function device that you're supposed to press buttons to see what each one of them does. They haven't put a big red button on the Crest on touch panel or the X on touch panel that self-destructs the room. Yes, we're waiting for one, but yes.
Yeah, because sometimes waiting on the hotel technician to turn up, you'd actually have the room up and running and ready before they even arrive, and they're like, if you're an audiovisual technician, you use your common sense the same as if you're an IT technician and you kind of go, a PC is a PC is a PC. Yes, the logins might be different, but as a whole, it's still a PC.
Yeah. it is very true. keep your comments coming in on what grinds your gears. Lewis Frank says, no labeling of wires. You know what? That actually doesn't grind my gears. As maybe in a large scale capacity, if you're building a rack or you're trying to find what cable goes where.
I can relate to that. If you have 6 racks of AV equipment and you're trying to trace a wire, yeah, I think labels is very important.
You know what? I have to say again, I'm going back to the LTSMG conference and seeing some of the trade stands. And Huge Shot International, you know, those guys have won awards at the AV Awards for a reason. Their rack builds are so unbelievably structured and clean. They take time, they take effort, they really want to show off what they do behind the racks. And like, you can literally with your eyes follow each one of the cables beautifully. It's what every rack should be built like, but.
Yeah, because I've seen some on LinkedIn and on Twitter. There's a few AV rack building companies who put up images regularly, and the amount of compliments they get for what they do, and it's just, it is amazing. I got to say, it's like a piece of art to an AV tech.
It is art, you know. And some really, like, we're going to do a show at a later stage talking about the LTSMG and the difference. Stands and just different pieces that come up with regards, like, of course, it is a space management group, so you know, like, and Simon, you're still heavily involved in the project that you're working on at the moment, and you know, I guess space is always a key factor in your life and in trying to find that that extra square meter that you can put an extra table in for a conference.
Oh yeah, it's always like that. Space is always premium, trying to get the most out of the room. How far is your stage coming out into the room so I can get an extra table, which means an extra 10 people attending my conference, and which brings 10 new customers or whatever, 10 new clients or whatever the case may be. So it's always a push and shove. It's a negotiation or a dance, I think, often with your hospitality team.
Well, do you know what? It's an interesting question that we must throw out there to our listeners. Is the scene of a conference or meeting, are we getting away from the stage, the simple design concept of stage and podium, and do people want to, do the presenters want to collaborate and mingle with their audience more? Are we seeing the idea of a podium is old-fashioned, talking from the front? And in your view, with events that you've done, I know you've been very busy with project work, but do you see that that image is sort of disappearing, that you presenters don't want this big podium or stage in the room? They just want to be able to stand up, be heard, and all lights on the presenter.
I actually think it's still required. Okay. I think it's still happening, but I think the layout of your stage, so sometimes the podium is not, the podium in a sense is not really required, the physical podium, but there is a front. Yeah. There's often, it's a panel of chairs or high chairs or stools or whatever you want to call them. Or I've even seen some recently where it seems nearly like if you were doing, imagine a live James, you know, like James Corden does on TV, where he has like a set here and a set here. And so sometimes I'm not seeing where you kind of have a little panel over here, and then while they flick to the other side of the room and kill the lights over that side. And so yeah. I think it's getting, it's kind of like, it's changing the aspect. But I think, because there's a, one of our topics kind of feeds right into this about is projectors, a thing that's going or coming. Right. I've noticed because of space, projectors are becoming a less requirement, that people are looking for more. Or like media walls, LED screen backdrops, so they can go right to the back wall with very little space loss, where if you're going rear projection or anything like that, you're often losing 3 to 4 meters behind you.
At least.
Or you're losing, you are confining your speaker to talk to a certain point if you're doing front projection, because you can't have them walking backwards and forwards in front of your screen. So I can see why screens are becoming a thing of the past. I'm even starting to see some of the local AV hire companies here, when they put up their pictures, they're putting their ops behind the digital LED screens with a camera out front, and that's how they're watching. So they're doing all their mixing and everything from behind the screens now,
yeah,
versus out on the floor. So they're getting themselves more discreet. But I still think fronts are still required, but with digital screens or digital screens, digital signage, LED screens, all that kind of stuff, you can change your backdrop, so you can change scenes in the click of a button. You've gone from a white, shiny, sparkling, clean backdrop to maybe an orange or a green or something.
I think it's more about utilizing space wisely. Like we will stick some photos in our video podcast of this, which is available on our YouTube channel, of just different layouts. I think like the new Microsoft building, I think Google have it down to a T as well in Dublin, where you might have wooden steps that might bring you up to the next floor. But when it comes to an event, they just throw out some cushions on those wooden steps and everyone sits down. And it's using that type of space where it's not wasteful space and it can be used as a multi purpose design. I think that's getting popular, you know.
Yeah, I think that approach is definitely seems to be happening, because I think we were watching a video recently of LinkedIn, and they were doing that.
Was it?
Yeah. That's they were doing that kind of thing. So, but I did see something similar also when the Microsoft building opened here in Dublin, like cross multi floor presentations of and that kind of thing. So it's becoming a popular thing about utilizing the space you have.
If you're listening to the podcast and you have some great examples of good space management inside buildings, I know it's one of these hot topics that keeps on developing. You can get in touch with allthingstech.ie, or you can tweet Simon at Simon Lang AB, or myself, Justin Dawson at Justin or Dawson.
All Things Techie Podcast, brought to you by two tech junkies, Justin Dawson and Simon Lang. For more, visit www.allthingstech.ie for All Things Techie.